ॐ सहनाभवतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सहवीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः समस्तजनकल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरम्। I think we have seen so far the verses. Is it okay?
It's taking some time.
Verses up to 8. And that is the question of the fundamental nature. And before that, in the 7th verse, Shankaracharya said the fact of life is that we, so long as one is young, one's time is spent only in playing games, sports, and then when one is young, in the form of an adult, then the time is spent in parties and meeting friends and meeting their responsibilities. And when one is old, unfortunately, one lives in regrets. What one could have, should have, would have done. So Shankaracharya says, nobody thinks about the highest reality. Now in Vedanta, we see very clearly that the purpose of a life's existence is to free oneself from the endless cycle of action, reaction, karma, karma phala and all other things. Now, when we see that we are caught up in a whirlpool of what we do comes back to us. When we do an action, the result comes back to us. And again, do we do the action? It's like everyday eating. You know, you eat breakfast, at the end of another 3-4 hours after eating breakfast, it's gone. Then you eat lunch, say around 12 o'clock, and then 12 noon. By 3-4 o'clock again you are hungry. Then you have some snacks. Then again another 3-4 hours it's gone. Then you eat dinner. Again it's gone. Next morning again you eat breakfast. So is our life. Everything is there. At that point it becomes important. After some time you find that it's gone. Again something else comes. And that becomes important. You do all the things and then again after some time that's gone. So from a very narrow standpoint, everything looks so important. Everything's so, you know, highly prioritized. But after some time you'll find that that is only a small situation in which I have no other thing in my mind and I find that is the most important thing to do. That's what he said. When a person is close this down. When a person is in the state of a boy or a child, a girl, young boy or girl, their importance is only in game, etc. But after some time, what we find that that is not the priority. Friends, parties, hanging out. After some time, that is also gone. Then family. Responsibility, job, and then promotion, that becomes very important. And when a person comes to a state where, you know, 50, 55, 60, when one is retired, one finds that, what did I do? All these years, what I was doing? And nothing I did actually remained with me. So what we find is that it is everything is momentary priority. This is what Vedanta says. Everything has momentary priority. Absolute priority, absolute necessity is forgotten totally. See, like when you're traveling in a train to go to a particular destination, let's say you want to go from Delhi to Bombay or from LA to New York by train. I don't know whether anybody will venture that, but anyway, let us try. So there are many different stations that are coming by in between. So many people come in and stay for a while and then they get off from into there. When their destination comes, they get off. But if you say that, oh, this person, I have been talking to him or her, after some time you got very familiar with this person and you started talking, your interest and his or her interest is same, and both of you got engaged in a very detailed conversation about interesting things. And that person said, okay, bye, I have to get off now because my destination has come. Will you also jump off and go with that person? If you do, that means you do not have priority over your goal. That is the reason why in this 8th verse he says, Kate kanta kaste putraha samsaro yamativa vichitraha kasyatvam kaha kuta ayataha tatvam chintaya tadiha brataha. Oh, brataha means, oh, brother. Tattvam chintaya. Please think about your priority. Kasyatvam, of whom are you? Kaha, whom are you, you have born? Kuta ayadaha, from where have you come? To whom you are? Well, who is your wife? Who is your son? This life in this world is extremely wonderful. We find that when our priority is not clear, we think and we take anything that comes on our way as important. Because our attachment or idea or the identification with the highest goal of life is so vague. So here Shankaracharya says, Tattvam chintaya. Please think about this. What is to be thought about? What is that for which you have got into the train? Why are you in the travel? Why are you in this journey? You see, all bondages are because our priorities are not clear. Like for example, if you have a friend, and that friend, can you just put on the fan? Just push it up. So you have a friend. You have been friends with this person for a long time. Maybe say 5 years, 6 years. One day, you have a difference of opinion with this person. He said something which you don't agree, or you said something he doesn't agree. You don't agree with me. I don't want to be friends with you anymore. If you say that, you know what is really happening here is, you don't value that person's friendship. If that friend is a real friend, he can have his own opinion, you can have your own opinion. And each one has a right for his or her own opinion. It doesn't mean that that person should agree with you all the time or you should agree with that person all the time. Not necessary. Opinions do not make the person. Person is independent of the opinion. Let us say a tree is there and it has many fruits. The tree is independent of the fruits. Some trees may not give fruits at all. Or one fruit may be tasty, another fruit may be bitter. Doesn't mean the tree is bad. Can you say that? Similarly, I have an opinion which you may not like. Or you may have an opinion I don't like. That doesn't mean that I start hating you. Bondage is created when we don't think clearly. So here you see, if that person doesn't agree with you, I don't like to see that person, I don't want to talk to that person. That means you creating your own bondage. How long you are going to go on like this? How many people in this world will like you? How many people will accept your opinion? If any and every other person doesn't agree with your opinion, half of the world you have to hurt. And so you have created your own hell. One half you are running away from, one half you are running towards. That's what we do. So bondage is because we do not understand the relativity of things. That's why Shankaracharya says, who is your wife? Who is your son? Kate kanta kaste putraha. Kasyatvam kaha kuta ayadaha. Where have you come from whom do you belong to? So you as an individual jiva, individual being, has come into this world to fulfill certain responsibilities and do some work. If that is forgotten and you have taken your role so seriously, just like a person who is acting on a stage, if he understands that it's only a stage and only acting, he's safe. If he becomes that very role itself, he's caught up. So, your wife, when you say, this person is my wife, okay, when? From the day she married me, right? Or I married her, fine. Before that, who is she? Who was she before that? She was a happy daughter of somebody. Now the miserable wife of yours. That happy daughter of somebody, she has married to you and then now becomes she is miserable. Now, she is wife, all right. But then, wife is only a relative reality. That's why it's called reality, relatives. Wife is a vesha, a role she is playing as much as you, as a husband, you are playing a role. Please understand the role. Your professor is playing a role of being a professor. You playing the role of your father's son. You playing the role of your friend to your friend, you are a friend. You playing the role of a brother to your sister or brother. Please understand the role. Role is not the priority. Priority is totally different from it. If the priority of life is forgotten, role becomes so important. If the role is considered as a priority, then your goal is forgotten. Just like as I said, they gave the example when you are going in a train and if you think that that person got down, therefore I also have to get down, you will never reach your destination then. Because you are going to get off from the train and then after getting off and then going about in the city, suddenly you find where did I start from? Where am I supposed to go? Kate kanta kaste putraha samsaroyam ativa vichitraha kasyatvam kahakuta ayadaha. Of whom you are, from where you are, you have come, tatvam chintaya tadiha bradaha. That you remember very clearly. Now, one may ask, Swamiji, all that you are saying about keeping our priority clear, goal clear, role is only a temporary, all right. But I don't see that way people around me. Everybody is taking their role so seriously. Everybody is so caught up in their own work schedule, their own daily routine, and so caught up. Absolutely don't have any time for anything else. You know, in places like New York or Bombay or such big cities, if you see people walking by, everybody's like a robot. Nobody looks at anybody. Nobody even have a time to smile at anybody. Everything is like a robot. Keyed. They are given a certain, you know, they have been programmed. Go straight to the office, work, go straight to the registration, take a train, go to home, eat, sleep. Again, get up. So, are all programmed. Everything is as per schedule. Nothing, no deviation, no human element. So, when we look people around us, all of them are so caught up in their own world. You have your own world. Your world is not my world. Your world is your studies, your reports, your assignments, your friends, your parties, your hangouts, your vacation, your world. My world is different. So when we look at it, everybody is caught up in their own world. iPad world, iPod world, iPhone world, Disney World, Universal World, video games, this, that, so many, they are all caught up. Everybody is caught up in their own world. So one may say, Swamiji, all that you are talking about, these are all hypotheses. I don't think it's at all possible. Now you see here in this verse number 9, Krishna Shankaracharya says, to come out of our preconceived notions, to come out of our misjudgments and absence of inquiry and wrong priorities, there must be something that we need to do. Without which, we will be like anybody else. Bound in their own anger, lust, passion, greed, jealousy, hatred. You can never come out of it. So that is what is called satsanga. Satsanga means not a set of people. That's what usually, I am going for satsang. Satsang is, a set of people who are talking about some sense in life. Putting some sense, common sense. But satsang is not just people. What do they deal with? What do they talk about? What is that discussed? That is most important. There are people who go for satsang and they sing some bhajans, eat some prasad and come home also. It's as good as going to a basketball game, wasting 2 hours of time. That's not. Satsang is where you become connected to Sat. Sat means what? What is a fact? What is real? And what is not real? What is important in my life? What is secondary? Not that unimportant. Secondary. It's not very important. This clarity should come. This clarity that which gives is called satsang. It can be book also. You read a book of a person, a great saint or great soul who had lived a very intelligent, very knowledgeable, very wise life. And when you read the life of such people, how they dealt with situations, you will realize that, oh my God, I never thought it this way. Suddenly you will find that you can think differently also. We have been thinking in a particular way and we think that is the right thing. We never allowed any other viewpoint at all. So satsanga gives various viewpoints, different standpoints through which you can see the same life. It is like you are watching a movie. A movie is shot in a particular angle. And in the cameraman, if he is very, the director of camera, it's a director of what do you call them? Cinematography. A cinematograph, cinematographer. If he is a very trained person, he will not use just one camera. He will have many angles. Why many angles? Because a same thing can be shown in different ways. From different angles, it will look differently. It will sometimes so beautiful. You take a camera and shoot a picture, whereas a trained person takes the same, what you call, picture. From a different angle, it looks so beautiful. Because the light, the shade, the color, the angle, everything matters. In the same way, in a satsanga, you are given different angles through which you can look at a situation. Okay, so you will understand, your own opinion is not the last opinion. Your own viewpoint is not the highest viewpoint or the absolute viewpoint. You come to recognize that. So here we see, satsangatve nisangatvam, nisangatve nirmohatvam, nirmohatve nischalatatvam, nischalatatve jivan muktihi, baja govindam, govindam baja mudamade, samprapte sannihite kale, nahi nahi rakshati dukrinkarani. So, satsanga, that's the first thing. It can be three different ways looking at it. Satsanga means sat vastu sanga. Sat vastu sanga. Association with what is fact. Sat purusha sanga. Association with good people. Sat Vritti Sangha, associated with good thought. All the three are possible. Now first take first one. Satvastu Sangha. Satvastu Sangha means association with what is fact. Now you have, let us say that you are a science student. When you were, let us say, 5th grade or 6th grade, your understanding of science is different from when you are doing MS science. Right? What is the difference? Your views are more mature. Your understanding about laws of nature is so different. Let us say you are a physicist at this present moment. MS physics you are doing. Your understanding of the world is totally different from what you started with when you are 5th or 6th grade. Why? Because you have understood the intricacies of the physical laws and many other things. That science is all about how to understand any object. How deeper you go, the deeper you go, more abstract it becomes. Correct? I met a physicist, you know, a long time back, and we were in a conference, and the topic was consciousness. So when he was talking about the nature of consciousness, which is subject matter of Vedanta also, he said, when we start analyzing a physical matter, any physical matter, when you go on breaking down to subatomic level of that physics, some matter, subatomic level, you will find at that level, the atom particles are unpredictable. Which is such a different theory than what we have thought of. A inert matter, any inert matter for that matter, any inert matter is inert. According to our perception is what? It is inert. It cannot, it does not have its own choice of where to be there or what to be there, etc. But that is not the truth. At the very subtle most level, they are equally alive and alert and vibrant as you and I are. But their level of awareness is so low, and therefore it looks like they are inert, but they are not inert. And I told him, my God, this is what Vedanta says. Because other than Brahman, there can exist nothing. So even that the matter has very ultimate subatomic level, the matter is consciousness. So, as a physicist, even Einstein and such other people also, they ultimately concluded that this is true. There's nothing in energy in motion is matter. Right? Correct or not? So what is the matter? It's energy in a particular motion. Particular situation, it's called matter. So, even a physicist, when he goes to deeper and deeper and deeper, he comes to a conclusion which the philosopher does. So, we will find that as we progress in our thinking, we will find that the truth is ultimately only one. So, what is satsanga? Satsanga to start with is thinking in terms of facts, not in thinking in terms of emotions, feelings, your opinion, my opinion, her opinion, his viewpoint, other's viewpoint. That is all fine. Finally, all that amounts to what is real. Right? So that is why it's called Sat Vastuni Sangha. What is Sat? What is there? What is true existence? So that is one. People who have thought about this, who have thought about what is the fact of everything, what is the substratum of everything, they have absolutely no problem with the world. Tragedy or comedy, success or failure, gain or loss, joy or sorrow, they know how to settle down. And therefore, Mahatmas or saints are those who don't fight. They have nothing to prove to the world. They have nothing to gain in this world. They have nothing to lose in this world. And therefore they are calm and peaceful. And when we associate with such people, we realize that That is the way to live. You know, Narendra, who was later on known as Vivekananda, he was a highly evolved thinker even when he was a student in the university. And he never believed that there can be a person who has seen God. It's not possible. God cannot be seen. But when he came to see Ramakrishna, who was a very rustic and he was not a very highly educated person or anything, when he came to meet him because of some contacts, etc., he came to Dakshineshwar, that's where Ramakrishna Paramahamsa lived. He went to see him. And when he saw him, he said, this rustic, uneducated fellow, how can he be a person of God, where I, the rational thinker, who has studied so much, and I have been debating and thinking about it, how can that be? I don't think this is. Lo and behold, it is to that same Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, ultimately he became a disciple. How? Because such a Mahatma, even though he is not a person of university education or anything, but his idea and thought about the world and the existence is so clear, right? Because of personal experience. He may not have gone by somebody's fantastic Western theory and then philosophy book, nothing. On his own, he thought about it. He inquired about it. He explored it. And he found it. Once found it, no doubt about it. So, Satpurusha Sangha is very important. To be in association with people who are exploring what is true, that association is very important, because one may suddenly start thinking one's own intellectual ways and find no solution at all. At that time, we need the help of people who have already walked the path. It is like you are driving a car and suddenly you find that you have lost your way. Don't you ask people, hey, I don't go, it seems I am not going anywhere. Please tell me which is the way to go. You ask somebody. And the person is a local, he will say, oh, this road is stopping here. Actually, this road has a deviation, go this way. In the same way, Satpurushas are those people who have already walked the path and know the problems that are ahead of us, and they will be able to guide. Therefore, associating with them is also satsanga. These association with good people or association with a group of people who are discussing about it cannot be all the time. Therefore, we should have the third one called Sat Buddhi Sangha. We should have the correct thoughts in our mind. Once we develop the ability to bring good thoughts to our mind, and unconsciously removing the unwanted negative thoughts, we are in safe hands. Because the negative thoughts, vulgar thoughts, impure thoughts, anger, passion, etc., will come to us. How do we deal with that? We cannot run to somebody else at that time. Oh my God, I got so many thoughts, what will I do now? Where do you go? So, you know, when you are in the university or somewhere, there can be bad elements around you. There can be people who will drag you to drinking and smoking, dancing and whatnot. At that time, who will protect you? Your parents are not there. Elders are not there. Everybody is in the same stupid category. And they don't know what they are doing. They are doing it because everybody does that. You also should do that. So, Sadbuddhi, the correct thought, that Sangha is important. So that development of the correct thought is important. So satsangatve, due to that association with good thoughts, association with what is truth, association with good people, if one has that, then there is nissangatvam. There is a certain amount of detachment, dispassion, not getting affected by things outside. There is certain amount of immunity you create around yourself. Nobody can influence you that easily. You will not get carried away by things. You will not be a slave to things. That is called Nissanga. Nissanga means where you know how to detach yourself from a situation. Where you know how to mentally withdraw from a situation. See, when somebody says something which you don't like, somebody is hurting your feelings, you can get hurt and then cry and all those things. That's what we do. But do you have an option? Do you have a choice? Yes, what? Let him say, I'm not going to be affected by that. This strength comes from what? Where does that strength come from? You are knowing yourself from a different perspective. I'm not a person who can be influenced by anybody around me. I'm not a person who will get affected because somebody said something. I'm not weak. I'm not a slave. I'm not a volatile. So this strength comes by correct thinking. So when you have satsanga, you become immune to influences, immune to negativities, immune to negative thoughts, immune to depression, immune to dejection, disappointment, rejection from the world around. Satsangatve nisangatvam. And when you are thus not influenced by the actions of others or situations by around, you are able to allow things out of your own choice, you cannot be deluded by anybody. You cannot be overwhelmed by anybody. That's why nirmohatvam. Moha is delusion. Delusion means not knowing what is to be done at any given point of time. You are confused. Delusion is caused by wrong priorities. I'm not sure what to do. So, one has to So one has to know how to come out of that. So, nirmohatva. Moha is where, as I said just now before itself, where an individual is not able to clearly think and something else takes over. Wrong priorities. So, nirmohatvam. So, satsangatve nisangatvam nisangatve nirmohatvam. So, from the highest level of nirmoha, highest level of non-delusion, highest level of clarity is called liberation. Nirmohatve nischalatattvam. Clarity comes. When the clarity comes, there is freedom and liberation. Nirmohatve nischalatattvam. Nischala means unchanging. Tattvam, reality. So, you come to realize the unchanging reality of things. Then, liberation, you become free of the bondage. So, this is the path, Shankaracharya says, one has to take it up. Now, you are saying, okay, I am in the university, I am studying, my priorities are different, I want to get the degree or I am pursuing masters, I have so many projects to complete and all the same. Swamiji, I don't have time for all these things. Let me get a little old and after that this is possible. You may say that. Nothing wrong. But nothing wrong in starting it. Nothing wrong in starting the process. You may not go all the way, but at least start the process. How did you learn language? Not one day. You just repeated what your mother said or father said or somebody else said. You just kept on repeating. And then you didn't even know the meaning of it. Pa, ma, whatever you said. But later on you come to know, okay, this is what it means. Oh, this is different from that. So you slowly came to know what the word means and how to use the word for a particular need. So you developed the awareness and understanding of the language and finally you learned the language to whatever extent now you are speaking. In the same way, learning about the ways to liberation cannot happen overnight. It's a gradual process. So, you can start any time. You have to start, but don't say, after retirement when I become 70, I will start. By the time you are starting 70, you 71, you die. So, what's the point? Just before death, I want to learn. So, one person was in the deathbed. Then he told his wife, his son, my dear son, go and get me a Sanskrit teacher. So, son asked, why at this point, you are already 75, why do you want to learn Sanskrit now? No, you see, when I go to heaven, I need to speak to them about, you know, I need coffee, I need tea, etc. How do I say? So I need to learn Sanskrit so that I can converse with the people there in the heaven. So that I want to learn Sanskrit. This sunset, I don't know where, whether you go to heaven at all or not. Anyway, it doesn't matter. So he went and got a Sanskrit Pandit and he started learning. Bring coffee, take the tea and things like that. So after a month or so, he learned. Then one day the boy asked, "Daddy, you learned Sanskrit all right. Right? When you go to heaven, you want to speak to the people in Sanskrit. I understood that. But when you go to hell, don't you learn that local language there?" This fellow is a Punjabi. He said, in hell, Punjabi will do. That's a local language there. So don't start learning anything at the deathbed or ready to die. So especially spirituality is not for the dead. Spiritual science is for the living, for better living. So therefore, now you are alive, active, alert, ready to learn. Even though you may not have time, it doesn't stop you from learning from at your own leisure, from the books, from listening to certain audio tapes, or whenever time permits, going to a nearby satsang, nearby meetings where they talk about, you know, higher philosophies of life. So there's nothing wrong. Expose yourself. Suddenly you may find an interest to it. Like I did. I never was looking for any sadhu or anybody there. Absolutely no idea who is a Swami, nothing. But then I came across Gurudev accidentally. He was coming to visit the same place where I was living. And I went there and I started listening. It made a lot of sense. He said, "My God, this is so true. What he says is so true." So then, you know, the connection came. I could connect with his thoughts and ideas. And he said, "This is good." He said, "Never thought about it." And slowly, slowly developed an interest and learned more. So, satsanga is a starting point. Don't hesitate to do that. It can be some book which inspire you, or set up people who are talking sense, or some of the situations or association of good people who are probably meeting with the sadhu or a person of knowledge. You go there and learn. So, satsangatve nisangatvam nisangatve nirmohatvam nirmohatve nischalatatvam nischalatatve jivan mukti. See, jivan mukti is an interesting point. I think Shankaracharya in his great wisdom has realized that jivan mukti is that which is for sure. You know, many other religions also, if you take, let us take the Christianity or Islam or Judaism or any other such Semitic religions, they say, after death, you will be blessed by the Lord, and during the, you know, final judgment time, you will be taken to heaven. Even Hinduism has got many places. These kind of statements are given. Now tell me, have you met anybody in your life who has said that I have just come from heaven? Have you met anybody who has come from heaven? If somebody says I came from heaven, first of all you ask, which lunatic asylum from where you have come from? You won't believe that if somebody says I came from heaven. You know, one president of a country, he was visiting a lunatic asylum. Yeah? And he went there and he was to open a new block in the lunatic asylum. So, mental hospital, he went there. So, and he finished his, inauguration process, etc. And he had more time, he was walking around. So, one lunatic fellow, one crazy fellow was in the hospital, was moving around and he looked at him. "Hey, who are you?" So this president said, "Who am I? Be careful. I am the president of this country." That fellow said, "I also said the same thing. They put me here." Nobody believes me. You will be all right after some time. So, what I mean is here that why did that come now? Lunatic asylum. Why did I talk about lunatic asylum now? Any
example?
Example of? You are not listening to me. He is not listening. He is standing next to me, but he is not listening. Anyway, so the point here is that slow learning. You may not learn overnight. Nothing happens overnight. So you learn about how to look at things by association with the books or association with the people who are associated with good thoughts. Slowly, slowly you come to learn about that. So, Jivan Mukti, that's the point. Jivan Mukti is where a person can have that much of freedom where nothing in the world can hold him back. Freedom while living. Not going to heaven or any other place. Here and now. And that is it not that which you are seeking for? I want to be happy here and now. If somebody says, okay, do these things, you will be happy after death. Will you believe that? First of all, I do not know whether there will be anything going to be happy after death. You may all be happy if I am after my death, but whether I will be happy after that or not is a question for me. Number two, I have not seen anybody who came back to me and said, after death I was happy. Is there anybody who is telling you that? No. So how do you believe it? But Mahatmas are those who are happy even when they are living amidst us. So these great Mahatmas or great people of correct thinking, they live in absolute joy and freedom even while living. Not after leaving, while living. They are called Jivan, meaning while living, Muktaha, free. Jivan Mukti. It is like this, you know. Let us say that you are hungry and you go to a pizza parlor and you order your favorite pizza, a cheese pizza, let us say. And that beautiful fragrance of a pizza coming through that when they are cooking exclusively for you. And that plate is brought and put in front of you. And take your, you cut your piece and when you are eating, what a joy. So, the joy of eating pizza is while eating pizza. Not afterwards. Afterwards something happens to your stomach. That's, we do not know what happens to after that. I don't care. While eating pizza, I am so happy. While drinking coffee, while smoking the cigarette, in the same way, while living, being happy is the most important thing. What after death, who cares? So, while living in this world, how do I attain the absolute freedom and happiness? Now, I put these two words together, freedom and happiness. I have explained to you before also. Happiness does not necessarily give you freedom, but freedom necessarily gives you happiness. Happiness doesn't assure freedom, but freedom definitely assures happiness. Think about it. Now, you let us say that, I smoke and I'm smoking, I'm so happy. Now, after some time, you have to smoke. You have become addicted to it. And if you don't smoke, you become so agitated, disturbed. So, the happiness created by smoking leads you to slavery. You see that? Happiness due drinking leads to slavery, dependence, substance dependence, agitation, insecurity, anger, frustration, unhealthy, depression, everything starts. So therefore happiness doesn't give you freedom, But freedom is, by very nature, is happiness. What do you mean by freedom? Where I am not forced to be in doing something. I do everything out of choice, out of my own willingness, out of my own understanding, out of my own volition. That is called freedom. When you do on your own, out of your own choice, that assures happiness. See, somebody forces you to go to sleep. Will you sleep? You sleep on your own choice, right? Even when I'm not talking to you, you may go to sleep. Out of your choice. I cannot stop it. If you're tired, if it's too late for you, you're in the East Coast, whatever. It's too late for you. So, when I go to a state of sleep out of my own choice, that happiness I derive, maybe after end of the sleep only I come to know about it, but it's my choice. Nobody forced me. In the same way, we understand that any substance-related happiness leads you to only slavery. Independence, freedom leads to happiness. That is why he said, Nissangatve, Nirmohatvam, Nirvomate, Nischalatattvam, Nischalatattve, Jeevanmuktihi. So the dispassion, independence ultimately creates Jeevanmukti. Jeevan abhi muktihi. Even while living, you are free. Even while living like anybody else, you have choices. Even while interacting with the world which is unpredictable, you have happiness. So that is why this verse is so beautiful. Satsangatve nissangatvam. Meaning association with good people, association with good thoughts, association with good, the fact leads you to nissangatvam, dispassion. Nissangatve nirmohatvam, dispassion leads you to absence of delusion, clarity in about the priority. Nirmohatve nischalatattvam. When there is clarity in thinking, this determination of the right goal. Nischalatattve jivan muktihi. When the ultimate goal is realized, while living itself, you are free. That is such a beautiful set of ideas Shankaracharya put here. Now, verse number 10. Do we have time? Only 4. Is it many? Anybody has questions? I don't know whether you can type it here. Chat. Okay, there is a chat room there if you want. Okay.
You can also type it on there.
I don't think anybody is asking any question. Alright. Now, in the following verse, no questions from me, but thank you, Swamiji, for the wonderful discourse. I unfortunately have to go right now. Who is this? Mukul from Phoenix. Okay. Thank you for joining us. We'll see next month, second Wednesday. Next month, second Wednesday, which is what date? May
13th.
May 13th. We'll meet on May 13th. Okay. Okay. So, we will take up the next verse in our next session, because some of you may be getting late there. So, unless anybody has questions, we will conclude now. Next verse is verse number 10. There are certain factors, associated factors. When associated factors disappear, clarity comes. The clarity is when we recognize the components And when the components are correctly understood, the clarity comes. So how to think correctly? That is the verse number 10. And following that, verse number 11 is about how to determine the final goal of life, which after clarity comes the vision. Vision of what is the character. Okay, my friend, my internet connection was poor, but I wanted to know how can we become Jeevan Mukta while doing all our duties. This is by Megha Sharma. Oh, Megha Sharma. So, please understand, duties are according to the stage of life where you are. Like for example, if you are a student, your duties are one thing. If you are a householder, your duties are different. And also place where you are. If you are in the office, your duties are something. If you are at home, you have different duties. If you are along with your friends, your duties are different. So there cannot be a set of duties for everybody to follow, or a set of duties every day to follow. There are some, but not always. Alright. Now, spirituality is such a science, it is not a particular activity. I have told you this before also. It is an attitude and not an activity. Like, let me give you an example. You have a very dear friend of yours. Very dear friend of yours. May he or she, whatever. With that person, what is your attitude? What is your attitude? Your attitude of being a friend, right? A very loving, caring person, and he or she is somebody whom I can confide, whom I can share, whom I can, you know, discuss many ideas, etc. Let us say that person has gone to become a big president of a country, company. You know, you have not seen him for, let's say, 4 or 5 years. When you meet him in person, still your attitude towards that person is what? What is your attitude? You don't treat him like a president of a country, I mean of a company. You treat him as only a friend. Because as far as you are concerned, he's your friend. First and foremost. President of a company or a husband of somebody or brother, that is all secondary. What is this, your attitude towards that person? Friend. You meet him after 25 years, still a friend. He may be a householder who has a lot of children, and then he become a grandfather, whatever. Still a friend. Correct? In the same way, what Vedanta gives clarity to us is, everybody is ultimately God in action. Brahman. Absolute nature is Brahman. Relative nature is an individual. The individual may be anybody, man or woman. It can be a elder or younger to you. It can be your brother. It may be relative. It may be a friend. It may be a stranger. Whoever he be, whoever she be, whatever he be, whatever she be. Your attitude towards everybody is Brahman first. Absolute truth, he or she is like me, like anybody else. And, or you say in the relative plane, God in action. Through him, God is acting. God is getting certain things done through that person also, like as much as he is getting certain things done through me as well. So once you have this right attitude towards that person, you will not bother about what the other person does. It may be poor, he may be rich. It may be intelligent, he may be stupid. It doesn't matter to me. Because I'm not looking at that person in that way. I'm not looking about whether he is a black or a white or a brown or a yellow skinned. Whether he's rich or poor, educated or uneducated. All these things are secondary to me. He is to me, she is to me, he is Brahman. As much as I love my own self, I extend that much love to that other person as well. That person may not have the intelligence, that person may not have the maturity to receive that. You see? But that doesn't mean that I change my attitude. Because as far as I am concerned, so this is what is called practice of Vedanta, and practice of Vedanta in such a way to give you freedom. Why are we are not free? Because we look at that other person only, oh, I like this person because of this reason. I don't like this person because of this thing. I like this way. I don't like that way. I want him to be like this. I don't want to be like them. So we put all conditions, that is bondage. What is freedom? Not to put that bondage. Not to put those limitations. Not to look at the person in compartments. Look at it person as a whole. That is what is called Jivan Mukti, vision of a Jivan Mukta. That is the way a Jivan Mukta will look at the world. So it is not in any particular duty, or it doesn't say you must have fulfilled these things to become a Jivan Mukta. So therefore, Jivan Mukti is that correct attitude towards oneself and others, which developed over maturity of thinking. And such a person who can be young also, it can be old also. It doesn't matter. Is that clear? Narisam Swamiji, knowing the nature of the end of the Kali Yuga, how can one remain optimistic and motivated to continue to help the world? This I think earlier also you asked. Who was this? Right? No? Somebody asked me this question. Who is this?
Not in this section, maybe.
Janani and Rupini, you asked this question before also. I think this is the same question you are repeating every time when I look at you. So, I have answered this before. So, Janani and Rubini, I have answered this question that remaining optimistic is our choice. What happens in this world is not our choice. The world will come into an end. It may end up in Kali Yuga, whatever it is. It doesn't matter. Even in Krishna's time, in Rama's time, in anybody's time, there were bad people. All the time. When is that in this world that there was no bad people? All the time. Kamsa was there, Ravana was there, Kumbhakarna was there, Mussolini was there, and Hitler was there, and Saddam Hussein was there, and then Osama is there. So many different varieties of people who have come and ruined this world also. At that time, do you think that they were all not worried about it? Oh, what will happen? Such kind of Ravana is there. Ravana comes and goes. Somebody will take care of that. See, as far as I am concerned, let us move on with the idea that, okay, let me do my best. Okay, you cannot make sure that everybody does their best. That's not our cup of tea at all. I will do my best in given situation. That optimism one should never leave. Whoever is in front of me will receive the best of mine. That should be the attitude. Clear? Sorry if it is repeating. No need to answer that then. Oh, I answered it again to you. Okay. Aksh. Aryam Savaji, are you Jivan Mukta? Completely detached and truly free. I wish I am. Not yet. This is what our Gurudev also said. When somebody asked him, Are you free? Are you enlightened? He said, no, I'm waiting for you. So get ready and come to me and then we will go together. That's what he used to tell whenever somebody asked this question to him. So I'm telling you the same thing. Let us get going. And, okay, Janani and Rupini, did you get that clear? Thank you. Let us never lose our positivity. We will never lose our optimism. We'll never lose. See, this is what we have learned from Gurudev. You know, even whether it's one person in front of him or 1,000 people in front of him, he will answer the same way. His attitude never changed. That's what we learned from him. Doesn't matter who is in front of you. Give your best. Sun doesn't wait for a particular people to wake up and then shine. He shines, no matter what. Right? Whether anybody takes it or not, it is not its concern. I will give my best every day, bright light. In the same way, he said, just imitate sun. Just be bright and light and brilliant every time. Somebody who understands will take it. Somebody who doesn't understand will run away. It doesn't matter. Why should you bother about it? Okay. All right. Let us conclude now. We'll meet on May 13th, Wednesday evening at 7:30. Om Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinah, Sarve Santu Niramayah, Sarve Bhadrani Pashyantu, Ma Kaschid Dukkha Bhad Bhavet. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om.